Chaitali Bagh from the European Bureau of Aviation and Defense University, based out of Cyprus. This morning, we have with us a very popular face of the Indian industry who led the Make in India drive for Indian Army's Artillery Corps by giving it an indigenously made gun. We welcome Mr. Jayant Patil, whole-time director and senior executive vice president, Defense and Smart Technologies, L&T, to commemorate with us the 194th Gunners Day. Sir, ADU is privileged to have you on the show. I now hand over to our editor, Sangeeta Saxena, to steer the discussion ahead.
Welcome, Jayant ji. It's so wonderful to see you here, as always. So, you know, it was one of those days when we really cannot forget L&T, you know. We, as you know, we have the 194th Gunners Day tomorrow. And, you know, no Gunners Day will be complete without L&T for us. So we thought, you know, that you would be just the right man and it would be best to hear from the horse's mouth. So, you know, the drive has been wonderful and Make in India success story has been basically led, if I'm not wrong, and I'm sure I'm not, by L&T. So how does it feel, you know? Suddenly you've given 100 guns and Aarti's become very, very stealthy because of your input. So just tell us about it.
You said it, Sangeeta ji. For us, specific to artillery, Make in India campaigns began in 1989. And 89 was a conclusion of the first of the order from DRDO. But little before that, about 2 years of association with this particular program of DRDO, and that was Pinaka. And of course, as a part of development of Pinaka, we went through almost every possible way an artillery uses an equipment. The first about, I would say, a decade was enormous amount of learnings into what a gunner really needs. And having understood it well, couple of years later, we had seen that the toad gun as well as the, you know, the track gun and the wheel guns, all these programs which have been carved out somewhere around 2002, 2003. And I still recall the 2005 artillery modernization plan, which said we are going to be concurrently looking at 6 or 7 programs. Having seen the toad gun not really working out, multiple international participations and things not happening, one kept on wondering as to what is that we actually cannot do right here, because that's essentially what was foxing and occupying my mind. And we decided that rather than building everything ab initio, we'll have partnerships. So one of that partnership, obviously, at that point in time was with Hanwha, then known as Samsung Techwin. So with Samsung Techwin, we picked up a relationship. I think the good part of Samsung relationship has been that they really knew what Larsen & Toubro is and our own capabilities. Having studied their gun, we realized that this gun has very, very little chance of clearing the Indian trials. We know how tough our gunners are. And rightly so, because if they don't have the right equipment, irrespective of all the terrains we fight under, we need something which will work in all those domains and all those kind of terrains. And that's essentially where we decided with Samsung at that time that we'll need to change quite lock, stock and barrel multiple major systems of this gun. I think that's where our journey on the Vajra, as we named it. And that's the reason we said Samsung calls it Thunder. But for us, it's not Thunder which will work in India. We need something quite different. And 17 major systems from Thunder were offloaded. Brand new, we designed and built them in India. And the first protos actually went into the first prototype that was fielded for trials for Vajra. Now, having done that, we could find that the efficacy of this, putting it ahead, and the goodness of both the partners trusting each other completely, we saw all the user trials without a single trial which we missed out. So it was first time ever in history that 100% of Indian Army's need or the artillery's need was being met by somebody. Having heard for 20 years that every time a trial happened, the trial didn't go successful. We've seen in 80s, the trials were never successful. 90s, they were never successful. Even the 2000-2010, there have been multiple trials. I think having really gone through the some amount of detailing on that, we knew what works, what doesn't work, what needs to be completely changed. And the customization, obviously, for Indian Armed Forces has to happen here. And that belief of ours actually came true. The rest, of course, is a matter of history. We created a complete factory, and artillery has been extremely happy wherever this gun has gone. It has brought name both to the product as well as to the company and the Indian artillery.
You know, sir, we are going to ask you something, or rather, let me say, I'm going to make a statement. L&T has, you know, everywhere, wherever we go abroad, we always feel that it has been the trailblazer when it comes to, you know, getting defense contracts. Now, earlier it used to be everybody knew L&T for construction. Now, suddenly the world outside knows L&T for defense. So what would you like to comment on it, sir?
I think it's something that you put in the sector. Also, the recognition. We were one company that did research for nearly two decades before we could start receiving our first RFPs. I think that is what made us completely different. The first RFP issued by Ministry of Defense to private sector came to Larsen & Toubro. The first complete system design and development contracts from DRDO started coming to private sector. Again, the first was Larsen & Toubro, and that was from Dr. Kalam to what we were made to do for the Integrated Guided Missile Program, the IGMDP. Of course, when it came to the physical buying by Ministry of Defense, the first RFP, of course, among what went to the private sector was Pinakas. Come the offset, around 2006-07, the first offset contract from the Israelis in India was with Larsen & Toubro. So we have been at that kind of an, I would say, cutting edge, doing things in the country. And one can say that there's a recognition which followed. So of course, with respect to what you just said, Sangeeta ji, about the external world, your product speaks for yourself. And when the product does well, of course, every user wants an equipment. I keep hearing this from our Armed Forces leadership. When they go out, people ask them about some of these products. And it's a matter of pride that we started getting export contracts, not only for having reached out to those places, it's for an amazing good word that was used by our own chiefs. So that's essentially where you create a traction for your own offerings, your own products, your own systems, which have started getting exported. And of course, more and more will happen. The more and more we find better ways to innovate in terms of what we can possibly do in terms of funding our own companies a little better, providing low-cost capital for the purpose of exports, which essentially will allow us to take competition head-on with the Chinese, matters will resolve out of that.
With your 100 delivery, and then, you know, there's been a little lull. So tell me one thing, there is some talk of 40 more. Have you also heard of it?
I've heard that the possibility of certain repeat, the precise numbers, obviously one doesn't know. And that's essentially part of the process. But the fact is that never ever in India, anything that needed a sort of a battle tank virtually being created, and instead of a tank gun turret, you now put in a much heavier turret called an artillery turret. So we decided at that point in time that we just have 3.5 years to deliver these 100. And if we go conventional, we'll just not be in a position to meet it. Having designed and built those first 17 systems, it necessitated that we make a factory specifically for this purpose. And I must say the then DJ artillery was General Shankar. And General Shankar has truly turned out to be an amazing person handholding the industry all through. I remember him right from the Pinaka days onwards. And he kept on encouraging. And I think what we built in this factory, of course, was completely out of the world in that sense. We had dozens of robots, 27 to be precise, which we were actually producing. I think that got us from that zero fault in the initial trial with the army that happened right from 2013 to 15, a replication of that in the production, entire 100 guns, we didn't have one single non-conformity. So we produced all of them extremely well, and it can't be done by one company. And there were 1,100 with 500 tier ones. So 1,100 industry partners, we build that supply chain. We know that 14,000 parts had to be made in India. And this 1,400 parts for each gun, 14,000 parts for each gun had to be qualified. So we built our own test tracks. The entire running gear ran on these test tracks for nearly 30,000 kilometers. So all of that really happened as a part of that qualification process. We didn't want to have anything that goes on to the gun which was not tested. I think the results were there to see, because we produced all those guns with nearly 770, 780 tests each under a gun undergoes, and not one single non-conformity. And that brought it. Now, this is something which was unthinkable, unheard in the Indian Army, for that matter, not only for artillery, but for any other program. I think that is why they really trusted that we also had an enemy knocking at our doors. And of course, that made a certain resolve in the army to take it to the forward locations. I think this is where the genesis of the repeat order comes from, because an equipment which was designed for the desert, supposed to run under those conditions of very high temperature, extremely dirty environment, sand all over, from there to the snow and the high altitude mountains. Now, this gun showed the ability, having gone through that indigenization in a very, very big way, showed the ability to perform. This is essentially where we believe there's something much more on cards. How much, as I said, we'll wait for.
Yes, absolutely. These tracks which you made for testing, they are where, in Talegaon?
No, they are all at Hazira. We set up a new factory at Hazira. If I tell you, it's a long shop. At one end, we actually put in plates, steel plates, the armor plates, which are cut to shape and size. With the stack of those plates, the whole hull and a turret is fabricated right there using these robots. There's a machining center which machines it, and then the assembly begins. Somewhere at the other end of the shop, you have a full-fledged Vajra walking out.
Yes.
So it's an interesting kind of a concept, which again, we believe that as engineers associated with the nation building, we need to create some of these stories.
Right, absolutely. And if I recall correctly, initially it was a bi-global. So, and then you actually made it a very heavy Make in India. So what was the aim to, do that? You felt that, yes, that was required.
No, you said it, Sangeeta ji, very right. It was bi-global. And the bi-global program, we tried to participate, I must say, thrice. The first time we participated with same Samsung Techwin, now Hanwha. And we were the single party. And the government of that day won't decide on a single party. So the tender was retracted. Second time the RFP was granted, the same ministry, same people, they said, no, Indian company cannot participate. And the first time, it's Larsen & Toubro who participated, because our partner believed that Larsen & Toubro is adding so much value and they won't have the ability to see through the trials in the kind of terrains we are talking about and the maturity which we bring to the table. They said, it's not our cup of tea to lead the program. You will lead the program. And this was a joint decision that Larsen & Toubro will lead the program. So Buy Global, as we know, an Indian company is as much part of the globe, and we use those exceptions to say that we can as well bid for the program. But as I said, second time when the RFP came, the interpretation changed within the same government, and we were disallowed to participate. Now, the goodness of our partner was, they said, without Larsen & Toubro, we are not bidding. Now, they did not bid. And then somebody else who bid was a single party. So again, the RFP got retracted. And third time, of course, that we see as an RFP that came in has seen this light of the day in terms of what we could field, all trials being successfully completed, production all subsequently completed. And of course, that's not just one major product for artillery today. L&T has till date done Pinakas in numbers. We have done the BM-21 upgrades in this country. And of course, there's a deeper relationship with the artillery.
Right. Absolutely, Mr. Patil. Mr. Patil, what I wanted to understand from you was that how much of percentage of indigenization has happened in the gun? What is the product line of indigenized content?
Being a bi-global program, of course, we had the freedom, and being a little conservative initially, we thought the first 10 guns we will have fully built in Korea, except those 17 work packages which were designed and built in India. For us, the whole of Vajra is 136 work packages. That makes it easy to focus and do indigenization one by one. And this is where the first 10 guns, although they were supposed to be fully built and imported, we did about 25 to 30% indigenous content on those. So these 136 work packages, roughly about 40-45 work packages we did in the country, even for first 10, including the full integration. The first gun out of that what we integrated in India actually came to the Defexpo in Chennai. And this was from the date of contract, if I remember, about 8 months. And that was a kind of speed. And we started building confidence in our own ability, the entire team started building confidence, and we said, no, now next 20 that we are going to be doing. So from 30th onwards, we plan to reach 75%. And we achieved it. Now, 11th onwards, we see that we were somewhere around 70%. So there was a major jump from that 30% to about 70%. After 31st onwards, we actually scaled it to about 83%. So that's where we started building those 14,000 parts a gun. And as we counted, it's about 1.4 million parts which have been produced in the country across these 100 guns. And that makes the entire life cycle calculations from Indian Army completely different. Instead of importing each of those parts at a later year during the overall life cycle, they're all going to be indigenous. What it also means is we are someone who necessarily as a part of the bid have to commit on today's price, and all that the government will provide us at a later date would be only an inflation correction. And we're happy with that, because bulk of what we know, when spare parts come from overseas, they are charged with a multiple. What that multiple is, all of us can keep guessing. Here there is no multiple. There's just a small incremental inflation correction is what the government provides, and we believe that as a responsible corporate, primarily focused on nation building, that's perfectly something which is okay with us, because across programs that we've been giving to Indian Armed Forces, that's the same formula. And we provide the life cycle. So life cycle costs for each of these equipment in times to come is going to be completely different. And that was primarily the purpose of this 83% work packages being done in India.
So of did it make the gun cheaper? Did it make the gun
cheaper? It doesn't really make it cheaper, because first time when you are putting all these costs into development, you're actually bearing much higher developmental costs. And of course, you have a target cost. This 83% what has been done in India costs a little more than 50% of the gun price. The balance 50%, obviously, along with those, the rest about 17-18% major subsystems still goes out. Since there were only 100, we couldn't have made the armament in this country. 100 is too small a number to make the barrel, breech, the muzzle, and of course the shock isolation system, the recoil mass and those things. So that's something which we never attempted. But at the same time, most expensive part, that the engine and transmission, if I say major, these are three major things which obviously come from the partner. And of course, the rest of the entire, whatever is mobile, is completely done here except the engine and transmission. The weapon system side, except the gun, everything else is indigenous.
Which also means that you created a great ecosystem for the Indian industry, the ancillary industry.
Absolutely. I said those 1,100 chaps. You know, Vajra is not Larsen & Toubro's success. You said it at the beginning, but I must say it's all of those 1,100. That last part, if it didn't come on the right time, on the right day, we couldn't have integrated a Vajra. So it's about that relationship. My team did some amazing things. They called bulk of them. At each of those sessions, you had 100, 150 joining. And we took them to our own, what we call as the Leadership Development Academy of L&T. We have a beautiful campus at Lonavala, which we used to call, earlier days called Management Development Center. We now call it Leadership Development Academy. And we had absolute closed-door sitting sessions, no holds barred. Tell us what your problems are, what is that you require. This is our plans. And I think there was a good handshake. And that's what really made Vajra succeed. Parallelly, we were working, when the Vajra was getting developed, we were working on a toad gun. So it's the same toad gun. We could get some amazing performance out of that toad gun. A completely different partner. In this case, it was a French partner. And we knew the French did not have a toad gun. So toad gun was created. We just said, you give me just the armament, everything else I will design and build in this country. So my toad gun, which again went through every possible trial, 100% succeeded, completely indigenous in terms of everything else below the main armament. So except the armament, everything is indigenous. I think these success stories happen simply because you have a large ancillary base and you have a relationship of trust. Without that, it doesn't happen.
Also, sir, when we talk about an armament, we also talk about ammunition. So, have L&T never thought of forming joint ventures and partnerships for creating that ammunition within India?
Not really. I must tell you the reason for that. One is, of course, that Vajra is supposed to fire. And as per the original RFP, where the biggest of the challenge of Vajra was, the RFP stipulated that there are 10 types of ammunition Indian Army has in stock. And it must be capable of doing, handling and firing all of them. Now, this is something as good as asking 10 fire control computers inside the same gun. Now, no gun in the world will do that. Now, the fire control of Vajra is Larsen & Toubro's. It is Indian, including the algorithms and all the corrections to the algorithms that are built in. It's all indigenous. Now, this is where we are able to make a gun which can take any ammunition. We also built in features that if you have three types of ammunition in the autoloader, it's a gunner's choice. He can get any one of them. Next shot he wants to fire, he can get the ammunition of his choice. Now, that's a feature which never existed in any weapon system. Now, you can actually have a carousel which is loaded with different type of ammunition. You don't have to program where you put what. The system has the intelligence to understand which ammunition is in which slot. I think to that level of intelligence has been built into the system. And that's the contribution of our Indian minds. So today when Vajra works and fires, you see multiple rounds being fired at the same target at different elevations. They all land at the same time. Now, each of these fire control related scenarios come because of this amount of intelligence and knowledge which has gone in. So it's not just making parts. It's essentially that has taken us miles and leaps and bounds ahead in terms of how to get the complete system built. I think that's the success of Vajra for the Indian industry. And the supply chain has actually proven that there may be heterogeneous 1,100 companies. As I said, 500 tier ones. That there are nearly about 600 tier two companies. Now, each of them never ever had an issue. Pluses, minuses happened. COVID started happening. Now, after the delivery of about 60, 70 guns, the last few, we still had to finish. And there was COVID. We remember early last year, everything was locked down. Now, we still had to manage. And we still did the Vajras ahead of schedule. So that's, the power of, the trust. You tell a person, I'll help you out. There's enough things to be done. Of course, the SIDM relationship and the relationship with the Ministry of Defense mattered. We're the first ones who started complete digital inspection. DGQA had never done a digital inspection in their lives. But this is one program wherein, with all the blessings and the good wishes at the top, people started doing it. So you could show that the effort to press a pedal is high, low, or medium based on the person who is sitting in the driver's seat and the effort which he is putting in, captured and digitally transmitted. The thousands of tests that happen on the system actually being done and digitally carried on secure lines, because obviously we are going inside a weapon system and should not be available ever to a wrong person. But the digital inspection actually took off. We had a flag off by the Lieutenant General in charge of DGQA, the head of DGQA those days from Vijay Chowk. The success story of this digital inspection, which started picking up, actually made him do it. Then we knew that, yes, we can manage this open area kind of an environment even for flag offs. Of course, then we called in the Raksha Mantri, we called in the Defense Secretary, every dignitary in ministry, they came for the flag offs.
Yes, absolutely. Also, now you made a successful one. You have a partnership which is successful. Now, with all this together and a country which is there to support you, your lines, your testing lines, everything, all that you said is available. So what is the plan to export Vajra?
Vajra, of course, a whole lot of indigenization, and I would say the better word for it for any international player, it's a desertization. We made a system good for deserts. We made a system for high altitudes, which we can say confidently today. When we built it initially, the target was never high altitudes, but today we know it works. Now, this is a combination which essentially is making a lot of people show interest on Vajra. So let me say Vajra Exports is a WIP. It certainly is on cards, certainly being talked about, but it's still right. Something we don't have a definite kind of a success story to talk. When it happens, we certainly will talk on that.
When we talk of Vajra and we are talking on Artillery Bay, we'd also like to extend it a little to other things which L&T has been doing for very long, like BrahMos. You know, you've got a major partnership with them. And so where is it now? Between you and Russia, yes. But where else?
In fact, between us and Russia, unfortunately, we're not someone as a company into part and component manufacturing, which is what Russia today is trying to focus on. We're people who would do complete systems. Incidentally, Vajra, we won against the Russians. And they were the ones who were in the last phases, still in the trials. Because initially the program started with four companies participating. In the testing phase, the field evaluation trials, it was only us And we were actually flying an Indian flag on Vajra, because we noticed that the Russians came in with their own flag on their gun. We said, no, it's an Indian flag that Vajra will carry. So from that day onwards, the trials happened, and call it the blessings of the flag, we never had a problem on any trial. And we could see that every alternate trial, the Russians having problems. I think the outlook of the Russians completely changed. Vajra was one program because of which they completely changed their ways. You know that in case of Russia, any partnering in India, necessarily they wanted to do only with a government company. Why is the Russians started talking after Vajra that we can also work with private sector? I think that's a lesson out of Vajra.
Yes,
of course, there's a lot of debate and discussions happening with Russia, but of course, nothing concrete today, except for some of the other programs which we are associated for other armed forces.
Also, you have something in the offing with Vietnam, is it true?
Vietnam, we did deliver certain, I would say, high-speed boats. It was a line of credit which Government of India had extended. Incidentally, on the Vietnam program, we have completed our deliveries. We had taken an order for 12 high-speed crafts that are capable of typically 35 to 40 knots. And that was with a conventional propulsion they wanted. The Indian version of it can go even higher. It goes to typically 45 to 48 knots. And that actually is done using a water jet. We built our own water jets for that, but of course, with the Vietnamese, given the quality of their coastal water, they didn't want a water jet, they wanted conventional. And with a conventional propulsion, the ship actually does about that 35 to 40. Five we were supposed to build in India, and in deference to what our government wanted us to do, these are aluminium boats, they're ultra light. And that's an amazing alloying composition, which actually gives you life under the conditions of our seas. So when we build these technologies, and this was again design and build in India, this design and build, we won against a global competition. This was also for Indian Coast Guard. When we won this program, was a bi-global program. We won it. We designed the boats. We qualified those boats. The designs were qualified through various trials, and based on which, we actually produced. So with our Coast Guard, we have 54 of them in service. And as a follow-on, since the Vietnam border guards actually saw this product and expressed the wish that they have it, we took an order for 12, five we built in India. And as what I said, the government allowed us to support the Vietnamese with these technologies. So the next seven boats are actually being built in Vietnam with a complete material package going from India. So here the reversal of what has been happening all along. We have always had
transfer of technology and offsets.
Built here with an entire material package coming from the foreigner. Here's the case where entire material package is going out. And of course, with that, a construction happening there. So this is an amazing success story again. Ships in India have been, as I said, completed. Physically, four are in Vietnamese possession. The fifth still awaits availability of ship. The ship has been delivered to them.
Yes.
While in case of the Vietnamese, they simultaneously are building all these ships. So another couple of weeks, couple of months, they start completing it, because they obviously had a bit of a lag over what we started with.
Absolutely. Also, what I wanted to understand from you, sir, is that at the moment, we have, you know, Navy and Marine has always been a L&T success story. So for the Army equipment, is there a very good joint venture with other countries, like you have the ones with Vietnam? So is it, because I always feel that L&T is only present when there is an Army show. There's a defense show, L&T is always there. So, which are the other countries you've been interacting with?
In fact, obviously, for varieties of strategic reasons, Government of India does not want us to talk very freely about the countries. But today what is happening is in the we know that the Prime Minister talked of look east, and the look east truly is happening today. There are multiple countries in this look east side whom we are working with, and there are different kind of capabilities one is granting, and all these capabilities came out of what we did for our own armed forces here. So it's happening right across. There's tank upgrades happening outside. There's weapon systems deliveries happening outside. Again, for the reasons, as I said, I don't want to talk about the names of those countries, but that's something which we know. In India, for any export, you have a export clearance from government, and wherever the government wants only, you will be able to do some of this work. Government has turned extremely positive. From 2015 onwards, we have seen that exports are truly facilitated in terms of what we want to do. The organizations, the Indian embassies and missions outside are truly there to help. So exports are picking up in a big way. And of course, Larsen & Toubro is at the leading edge, I would say, in terms of complete capabilities. If in terms of naval side, if a foreign navy says, give me a capability for air defense, and we can do that. We can do a complete ASW, anti-submarine warfare. We can do the complete surface warfare. So whether we talk of anti-ship or the anti-land kind of attack systems, we are all able to do that. So it's a kind of a today, having all these capabilities built in-house in the country, we are able to now differentiated way, give it to anyone who wants it from Government of India. Of course, Government of India is a stakeholder in that case. They facilitate what we are trying to do.
Also, I'd like to understand from you, what is the status of the L&T MBDA JV?
L&T MBDA JV, I must say that created yet another amazing benchmarks. We were slated to start deliveries, and the first of the major kits were supposed to arrive, and then the COVID came in. We had the entire team trained using Digital Connect. Again, secure links between the UK as well as the French teams from MBDA. And we started delivering the rear portion of, we know, the Mika missile. And the rear half of the Mika missile goes from this MBDA JV. We also started assembly integration and a lot of parts making for the launchers which are coming on our Rafales. So the Rafale missile launcher is made in India. And obviously, it has to go out because it goes to MBDA. It has to go out, gets integrated onto an aircraft there. Also, for various other places, globally, wherever it is going, some of these things have actually begun. The good part was a small team, typically about just 30-35 people, a brand new factory came in. We inaugurated the factory in the peak of COVID last year, and the factory started deliveries.
That's very nice to hear that. Chaitali has been waiting for very long. As in, when we talk about exports, you know, she has two major regions under her, Middle East and Europe. So, sir, for the next two questions, we'll hand the program over to Chaitali. So she might have her queries for you.
Sure, Chaitali.
Chaitali, go ahead.
Hello, sir. Well, it interests me, the Mediterranean region and the Middle East, definitely. But so I will focus my questions primarily to these two regions. So the Mediterranean region is very volatile nowadays, and hence it's seeing a major defense drive. And definitely it's a very great market to manufacture in, manufacture for, and create good partnerships. I was visiting DEFIA, and I saw, unfortunately, India, the Indian pavilion, the Indian companies could not participate there due to COVID restrictions. But people were very eager to know from me about the Indian companies out there, the Middle East companies, as well as the Mediterranean companies who were participating at DEFIA. So do you have an existing market in this region? And if not, are there any plans of L&T to tap this market here?
There are certainly plans. We've been doing, let me use that word, courtship in many of these countries. And as I told Sangeeta ji, We talk, especially with Larsen & Toubro, we talk only after we have actually converted it. We do see a huge amount of challenges in these places, and for good reasons, because many of these regions, we know the whole lot of conflicts, and it's a case of where government of India really wants us to go there. Second aspect, of course, after that is the Chinese competition. Obviously, we see that in terms of capability, bulk of what these regions require, including on the Lucas side, we today can serve them from India. And there's no platform we actually can't deliver today on our own to any of these places. Fact is, of course, we as a country enjoy some basic disadvantages when it comes to competing with the elephant in the room always is China. China obviously has very different terms to be offered to their companies to be able to do that. The only term in India obviously is the LOC, but the LOC has its own limitations because there is a cost of LOC, and the government doesn't have infinite budget to be able to provide LOC for any and every of that sale. So there's something obviously that needs to be done, and that's something which again is a matter of work in progress with the Ministry of Defense, and we all as industry majors are asking the government to do something little more, something little out of the box. Again, as it starts physically getting crystallized, about to happen any moment, we'll hear about it as policy pronouncement. So exports are something which today we need to be looking at, not just a matter of trade. It's a matter of giving a capability to that nation. Like as I said, in case of Vietnam, giving ability to this country as our friend of India must have that capability to build it on their own. And that's essentially where Larsen & Toubro was asked, you go there, build it there. So there's a Vietnamese shipyard which is today building the ships as what we can build them in India. So that's essentially will also happen many other places. Also, what will happen will be the specific kind of inputs that come through our, the missions overseas, the defense attaches, the ambassadors, and their kind of a handholding. It's dramatically changing. Fact, last point always comes on the price. There are countries who are willing to pay price as a preferential price, the countries who will ask you to be an L1. Third aspect is whether you did it with your own armed forces. And a sum total of all this finally will result into getting a contract. So we do have today lots of leads in this region. But as I say, especially in the Middle East and Mediterranean area, we haven't really made some big sales. Of course, I don't treat Israel to be out of the Mediterranean zone. Yes. But Israel, of course, has been a very long-term partner, and we've been selling a lot to Israel.
Actually, so as you talked about China, well, I'm staying here, and since I'm interacting with the defense people and defense sectors as well as the embassies here, I can tell you, and I have found this, that people's outlook have started changing regarding China and Chinese products. That is included, that is equivalent with the defense products as well. So do you see this can be something, an opportunity for the Indian companies like L&T to jump in and take this opportunity and grab it to have a good share in the market?
Absolutely. Because people are seeing very clearly that obsessive kind of control that the Chinese bring in, along with having given a sort of a line of credit. Now, the line of credit has served them well, but I don't really think it will work and continue to work in future. And that's essentially where the terms that the Chinese can and could offer, of course, we hardly can match, unless, of course, we do completely something different. We also need, as a country, preferential relationships between our government and those governments. Call it what the Americans call as the FMS sale. And that's where you build an exclusivity.
Yes.
So that's essentially where one is having good amount of debate and discussion, because staying within the box, we're not going to create successes.
Yes.
We have to think of going out of the box. And that's happening in today on the policy side, relationships with the other countries. Mm-hmm. Of course, we believe that in times that will start happening.
Even the trust factor is more on the Indian companies rather than the Chinese companies.
Yes, of course.
So okay.
People see the quality of equipment. People see what you are going to be providing. India also has an extremely good image of being frugal. We deliver a capability at a certain cost. Now, compared to the West, it's dramatically efficient in terms of cost. But with respect to Chinese, I think it's a quality that would make it different.
True.
Now, that's essentially where we seem to have a good pack, but at the same time, our cost of finance is one aspect that stops us. Because anyone who needs to borrow money, especially when you are selling overseas, you get the money after you build the product. So the entire working capital is a cost. So it's a little more down-to-earth kind of finance and related costs, which are what are going to be a decisive kind of a factor. And that's essentially where the government-to-government relationship matters.
Okay. So now we'll shift a little bit to the West Asia. With the West Asia also in a turmoil, it is also a very big market for defense business. So where does L&T stand in the Middle East for defense? For we hear of ECC doing strong business in UAE, Kuwait, Oman, and but defense seems to be a less spoken for L&T business in that region. So can you please comment on that?
No, in fact, bulk of these regions have always depended on the Western technologies and equipment. We know that you find either European or an American equipment there. Mm-hmm. Of course, at much, much higher costs. And there's a lot of motivation to change it. Must say there's some amazing initiative which the current defense secretary actually started. And he encouraged SIDM and FICCI to start very directly engaging. The 25A category countries where India has relationships now, we are engaging. Incidentally, 17 out of that, SIDM looks after. So last 1 year during COVID time, while we are not able to go anywhere, we are having enormous amount of digital interactions today on our own platforms, being able to show them what Indian industry does. There are different conclaves which are being done to be able to portray India in terms of what we bring to the table. So we believe that, of course, during the COVID time, everybody has constraint of money because money is today primarily being spent on, as RPM calls it, life and thereafter livelihood. So the life and livelihood is today far more important than something that you must. Obviously, defense, if there's no real issue, you might as well keep it for tomorrow.
Yes.
So that's essentially where one is seeing the market moving. But as we see, we are coming out more or less, especially in India, we can see next 3 months and probably almost everybody who wants would have been vaccinated.
Right.
I think that's a new beginning which we'll see.
Yeah. So I think, ma'am, over to you again.
Right.
I am satisfied with the answers that sir has given to me.
Right. Absolutely. Jayanti, before we wrap up, you know, you're a very busy man and you've given us so much of your time. But before we wrap up, we'd like to understand from you that L&T has always been very research focused. And R&D has been a very major activity and a lot of financial input when it comes to the budgets of L&T. So for L&T Defense, what is the current status quo of the R&D?
Sangeetaji, there's a history to what you said. This is a company which I chose to join out of a campus. And at that point in time, the reason was at 50 crore annual turnover, they announced they will form a corporate R&D and they're willing to spend 2 crores a year out of that 50 crore turnover. It's not income. So we obviously belong to an organization which believed in doing things on their own. and the corporate R&D, within 15 years, 10 to 12 years, we stopped getting into any knowledge-based transfer of technology or, for that matter, collaborations. We do work with global's best today across sectors and segments, but it's always at an equal relationship because we are at a position of knowledge. You can always trade off knowledge and not without money being exchanged. Now, this is what has made us to be what we are. I joined this corporate R&D at 22 years at the corporate R&D. Now, that's not a surprise that you have someone who actually knows elements of what is getting in. And that's something.
And sir, we'd like to just button to tell our audience that when you talk of joining from a campus, I'm sure the campus, they would want to know which is IIT Bombay for you, isn't it? So yes, to expect somebody coming out of IIT and choosing an Indian company and that, you know, so many years back is also a great compliment to the company.
Incidentally, my entire top team, literally a dozen of them, all of them are IITs. Call it, I've been able to hold them. I've been able to sort of give them enough challenges because all that one needs is not just money. We need challenges in life. We need satisfaction out of having really done something wonderful. So I think this is the mindset with which when we entered defense sector mid-80s, literally about 10 years behind us in the corporate R&D, this is what has made us do what you call today as Make in India. For us, doing it in India was always the first target, the first goal. The whole of what we do, see in the infrastructure and across every possible, let's say, core sector. I won't use only the strategic sector. Strategic, of course, is completely Larsen & Toubro across any of the domain that you see. And that's essentially where nobody else was willing to provide you any knowledge. Now, this is where the strategic sector turned out completely different because it had to be done in the country and they had to have good partners. And that's essentially where, whether we talk of nuclear power, space, we talk of strategic defense, we talk of oil and gas, we talk of hydrocarbon chains, everything today, Larsen & Toubro does on its own steam. Now, I think this is where the mindset of an organization completely changes. And I think that is visible in what we do across every of our verticals in defense. That's the same thing we do across all our businesses. I think that makes us do different. Of course, the R&D spend today is much, much higher, much larger. We only have a grouse against the government that at least against R&D, government used to provide some tax breaks. They took it away and they need to be doing some serious thinking about it. Right. Because they want Indian companies to grow and create an absolute fresh new R&D, then if you can't provide them the R&D money, you at least can provide them tax breaks. So that's essentially government makes us capable of putting more money. What we can afford, we obviously are putting on our own.
Also, you know, just before I say bye to you, I wanted to understand one little thing. There has been a division. Suddenly, you used to always have L&T defense, and now suddenly you have an L&T next. Huh? Now it has all. Is the all complete AI gone to that? And whatever AI is required for defense manufacturing, is it a collaboration between these two verticals of L&T?
In fact, specific to defense, wherever the applications of these technologies are in defense, it certainly is next because I also looked after next. For first 2 years, incubated in a way, the way I started defense. Next, recently, we merged Next into Mindtree because we realized for this kind of technologies, the markets are far larger outside. India still has the tender processes for these kind of things. And these kind of things you will do overnight within very short kind of cycle times. Whereas the tender movements won't happen at that pace. So that's essentially where we decided to leverage our own group entity with enormous amount of digital focus. And L&T Next, as you know, is the first digital, call it IT related company. I don't really want to call it IT, but it's the first digital company in the Indian IT sector, IT-ITES sector. So obviously, as a result, we decided that they must leverage what we do and then reach it to the Western Europe, they reach it to the Americas, and of course, other regions. And that's essentially where you just concluded that about 2 months back. So L&T Next now does even bigger things, but much more being done for others. Of course, on the defense side, every major program, wherever we are bringing in the predictive maintenance, we're doing it in warships today. We're doing it on Vajra. We showed it in Vajra in the 2020 DefExpo at Lucknow. We said, here's Vajra, here's all the sensors, here's the system, this is what it can do. The entire training of Vajra today is completely digital. And these are all come out of, that has all come out of our next initiative. The kind of AI tools you build in, even for the purpose of training, it's amazing. And we displayed some of that at that place. Of course, we said that sky is the limit. It's a question of the user wanting more and more. And of course, with that, one can do far more.
Thank you so much, Mr. Patil. It was so wonderful to have you here with us. And for, you know, we are very grateful that you gave us such a long time, you know, because we know how busy you are. And, you know, Chaitali and I both, you know, it's a complete company. ADU is a woman-focused company. And, you know, I can very strongly say that L&T has always treated us at par. You know, there's no gender bias at all. Absolutely. So it's wonderful to have had you at the show. Thank you so much, sir. Looking forward to having you again nearer the next Def Expo in Gandhinagar, so that we can then understand from you where in the last few months has L&T gone and what are its projections going to be. Sure. So, sir, thank you so much. See you again, sir. ADU is privileged to have you.
Look forward to
that. Thank you so much, sir.
Right, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Have a nice day ahead. Thank you so much.
Bye. Bye. Bye.